All right, what's happening, y'all? Great win for the Washington football team. Coming to y'all with a Washington football team versus Seahawks review. Y'all know how all of these videos go. I got to break down each position group and the most notable players from each position group, starting with the offense, then going defense, and then special teams. Of course, I have to update y'all on the very little we know about various injuries on the team. Of course, we'll get way more information by tomorrow, as in Tuesday. Also, Wednesday, when the official first injury report comes out. So I'm gonna keep y'all updated throughout the week on guys like JD Mkissic, Logan Thomas, Curtis Samuel, Joey Sly, all of those guys. But we're gonna talk about that a little bit during the video. But before we dive into all of that, make sure you subscribe to the channel, hit the bell next to the subscription button so you get a notification immediately and every time I release an informative and opinionated video just like this one. As always, man, make sure you check out the rest of the channel. All of my videos are organized in playlists. I even have a comedy playlist for all of my funny videos, and I'll keep y'all updated on everything breaking and go throughout the week, especially those injuries. And without further ado, let's get it. Just to let some of y'all know, you may not know, but we are now the 7th seed in the playoffs right now. Even with us not leading our division, we have the last spot in the wild card. Remember, they extended it to 7 teams in each conference. We are that 7th one. We just stole it from the Vikings after we beat the Seahawks. Entering this week, we were 11th, and after a couple of losses in the NFC and us beating the Seahawks, we moved all the way up to 7th. And now, us making the playoffs is in our own hands. We have the Raiders in 5 division games. Cowboys, Eagles, Giants. All very winnable. And if we match up well against Dallas and beat them, we should win the division. But let's get to this team, man. First of all, we always got to start with the quarterback, Taylor Heineke. Honestly, this was a good game. It was a good game managing type of game. Like, he didn't do anything necessarily spectacular. He made a couple of throws. That throw at the end to DeAndre Carter, I believe that was 4th down. That was huge. That was like the best throw of the day. He had another great throw, but generally this was a game managing game. Like somebody, one of the callers said in the post game live stream we just had, where I let y'all call in, y'all voice y'all opinions and everything, make sure y'all go check that out. Somebody brought up the point that was literally like Alex Smith but with mobility, and that kind of is what it was. The defense played very well, the run game was potent, so all he had to do was basically be like Alex Smith. Because honestly, without the refs hating on us, we're supposed to have easily more than 17 points. The Brandon Sheriff fandom call, we're definitely going to talk about the refs. And that Logan Thomas touchdown was definitely a touchdown. Great throw. Great job scanning the field by Taylor Heineke to get it to Logan Thomas. I mean, because he was sitting back there for like 5+ seconds looking for somebody to throw it to. He found Logan Thomas on Jamal Adams, and that was a catch, period. So even though the offensive output, if you look at the score, 17 points, that looks worse than what it actually was, but it still was a game managing type of game. Because against the Buccaneers and against the Panthers, Taylor Heineke was slinging, but today was more like a game manager. So I would not say Taylor Heineke is Alex Smith with mobility overall, but today he was. My boy Ivory brought up the point that he's really like a Tony Romo with less arm strength, and that kind of is what he is. He wasn't that today, but generally that's how he's been, especially in his best games. This wasn't one of his best games, but it was a good game. It was a good enough game to get the win with the circumstances that we had, again with a great run game and a really good defense that made plays when they were supposed to. Not gonna stay on Taylor Heineke too long. I mean, I still feel the same way I felt about him every week, so I'm not gonna hamper on him too long, man. Just congratulations for the win. You did exactly what you needed to do, and we appreciate you. 3-game win streak, man. Job was on the line entering the bye week. He came out of that bye week and has been balling since. Then we're moving on to offensive line. Overall, a really good game. Probably one of their worst pass protection games of the season, but that's expected when your backup guard is now your starting center, because your starting center got hurt. Your starting right guard that the backup guard, Wes Schweitzer, is supposed to play behind, he's actually been playing. He had a couple of bad moments today. I'm not going to count that holding penalty against Jamal Adams as one of them, because that was not a good call, but he did have another penalty. He got beat by Bobby Wagner. I think it was like in the first quarter or second quarter, where like Bobby Wagner literally just moved him out the way to go make a play on Antonio Gibson. I believe that was Antonio Gibson. So like, overall, he had a pretty good game, but he had some bad moments. But like, Wes Schweitzer, who's supposed to be our backup guard for Brandon Sheriff, because you pretty much count on him not playing a full season, is now our starting center. And then our starting right tackle, Samuel Cosmi, who was looking like he was Pro Bowl bound. He's now on IR. So you have Cornelius Lucas starting for him. And our offensive line is still playing very well overall. They run blocked very well today. Pass blocking was iffy at times, but overall good. But it was still like not to the level that we're used to seeing throughout this season. They took a step back in pass protection today. But again, that's expected with all of the injuries. And I think once guys have better chemistry with each other, because again, it's not even just like we have injuries and these guys have been out for forever. And the guys that are now starting have played alongside each other for a long time. Now, Wes Schweitzer just became the starting center as of last week. Samuel Cosmi came back last week, got hurt again. Now Cornelius Lucas is starting right tackle again. Brandon Sheriff has only been playing for like the past 2-3 weeks. So the offensive line is always being jungled around. The rotations are crazy. It would be different if like the guys that were hurt now were hurt since the beginning of the season and the backups had plenty of time to gel together, gain chemistry together, and learn how to work as one cohesive unit. But this is like a ever-changing offensive line week to week to week. So I'm just impressed with what they're doing overall, dealing with the circumstances that they're going through right now. Again, it was a slight step back in pass protection, but overall the offensive line still did what they had to do. I mean, when you run for 152 yards, the offensive line did their job. And it's amazing to see how good Charles Leno is now. I mean, you could definitely argue that he's a Pro Bowler. The first 3 weeks were a little iffy, but he's been holding it down. He's the reason why I feel like we don't need to go offensive tackle early in the draft, at least not this next season. I think Charles Leno can hold it down for like the next 2-3 seasons. He hasn't missed a game in what, like 5+ seasons or 8 seasons, some crazy stat where he hasn't missed a game for us or Chicago in forever. So he's like a staple left tackle that we don't have to worry about that position for years to come, at least for the next 2-3 years, and then we'll address it later, because Samuel Cosmi is our franchise right tackle. Cornelius Lucas is the best backup swing tackle you could probably have in the NFL. Same thing with Wes Schweitzer as a backup guard. He's already started at right guard for us. He's been a backup right guard, and now he's our starting center. So our offensive line has a lot of great depth, and once everybody's fully healthy, we're going to be right back to being a top 5 offensive line in the NFL. Then going to running backs, Antonio Gibson had himself a game. It's pretty much what he's been doing every now and then this season overall. He just avoided the fumble. But he's been running really hard. He's been making guys miss, getting more yards out of a play than he was supposed to, turning a 2-yard gain into like 8. That's just what he's been doing. I feel like the offensive line, Scott Turner and Antonio Gibson, need to figure out what's going on 3rd and 1s. And even though running delayed handoffs on 3rd and 1 out of the shotgun have worked generally this season, you can't keep spamming it, because the Seahawks just showed you that they will figure it out and learn to stop it. If we're going to run the ball on 3rd and 1, I prefer to do it out of I formation or single back. But I mean, it has been working in shotgun. It didn't work today though. But either way, Antonio Gibson, whatever, we got to figure something out for these 3rd and 1s. But other than that, man, he ran hard. He had 111 rushing yards on 29 carries, man. Shouts out to him. Also, just in case if you wanted it, Taylor Heineke was 27-35, 223 yards, a touchdown, and an interception. But Antonio Gibson ran very well. JD Mkissic was exactly what we needed in the red zone. I mean, he was out there making plays in the red zone. The first 80 yards, Antonio Gibson was clearly the better back. But when we got to the red zone, JD Mkissic was balling, and he had 2 of our touchdowns. 1 receiving and 1 rushing, man. We really need him back healthy, bruh. There's been an update by his agent saying that everything is all good, and then Logan Thomas told reporters that JD McKissick's just been walking around celebrating, chilling. I mean, and when he got on the cart, he kind of got on the cart himself. He didn't have his helmet on. Like, he looked like he was actually kind of chilling, and it looked like they were just taking precautionary measures, and it sounds like he's chilling right now. We'll see if he's in concussion protocol and if he'll be able to play for the Raiders, but it definitely doesn't seem like anything long term we have to worry about. I feel like worst case scenario, he misses the Raiders game, but other than that, it seems pretty straight. It's reported that it's a neck injury, but again, Logan Thomas said that he's out here just walking around celebrating in the locker room like nothing happened. So we'll see how that goes. And then I would like to see more Jared Patterson, but Antonio Gibson had the hot hand, and it was just hard not to give him the ball, bro. He was out there making people miss, getting more yards out of a play than he should have. And then moving to the receivers, everybody contributed when we needed them to. Terry McLaurin, I mean, he only had 4 receptions for 51 yards, but like, I mean, DeAndre Carter stepped up once again, and he was on a 3-game streak of having a touchdown, and he didn't get one today, but we really needed him for quite a bit of those plays. He caught a couple of first downs. touchdowns, most notably that one near the end of the game, the one where I said Taylor Heinicke probably had his best throw of the game. That was really clutch. We really needed that. He had that one drop, but then he made up for it immediately after that for another first down, not the one that I was just talking about near the end of the game. So, man, DeAndre Carter, shouts out to you. Adam Humphries even had a couple of catches. Guys are stepping up with injuries. Curtis Samuel, you know, the couple of times that he did get the ball, he looked good. He didn't look hurt. He ran somebody over him. He lowered his shoulder and got a couple of more yards, and it looks like he's still healthy. Thank goodness. Him and Logan Thomas look like, if anything, they're only getting healthier after this game, so I'm excited. No setbacks for Curtis Samuel. Speaking of Logan Thomas, the tight end group, John Bates blocked very well, had a really good catch somewhere in the beginning of the game. But Logan Thomas, man, that toe drag on the sideline for a first down was huge. That should have been a touchdown catch at the end of the game. Man, he showed you exactly why we missed him, making catches, blocking people very well, making very clutch, tough catches. Man, shouts out to Logan Thomas. We really needed him. I'm not sure if we win this game without him, honestly. He was that big of a factor in this game. I'm so happy to have him back. Can't wait to get Ricky Seals-Jones back as well. And then, before we move on to defense, Scott Turner, the first half was brilliant. I mean, the play calling was excellent. Then once we had that lead, that 17-9 lead that held over for a very long time in that game, he started to get a little conservative. But at the same time, I mean, if the offensive line blocked better, if Antonio Gibson ran better on third and one, we wouldn't be complaining about how conservative he was being, because we get those first downs, we keep the ball, we chew more clock, and then we're not even in the situation that we're in where it ends up being 17-15. Plus, it's not his fault that J.D. Mkissic and Antonio Gibson ran out of bounds all on that last drive when we were trying to run the clock out. So overall, still a great game by Scott Turner. I'd prefer for him to play call to win the game rather than to not lose like he started doing. But overall, still a good coaching game from him. There were some great play call designs. I mean, the fact that Terry McLaurin was open to the point there was nobody within 15 yards of him, when that's clearly the guy that defensive coordinators game plan against specifically. Like, we stopped Terry McLaurin first, and then we let anybody else do whatever. The fact that he was that open is Scott Turner. The fact that Logan Thomas is open with nobody within 5 yards, John Bates open with nobody within 5 yards, DeAndre Carter on that last play behind Logan Thomas where Taylor Heinicke threw that dot, you got to give credit where credit is due. I mean, Scott Turner was drawing up some really good run plays as well. On that final drive, you saw him just giving the Seahawks a headache that last drive with some of those run designs. Looked very Kyle Shanahan-esque. I was really proud of Scott Turner there. Again, not a perfect play calling game in my opinion, but still great overall. He made a lot of those plays. Again, Taylor Heinicke was just working within the means of the offense. He didn't have to make any really great plays other than some plays with his legs where he had to avoid sacks because, again, the pass protection wasn't quite to the standard that we're used to. But overall, that was Scott Turner moving the ball up and down those fields and chewing up all of that clock. Now moving on to the defense, most notably, before we even get to position groups, the Seahawks were held to 4 of 12 on third down. That is huge. As you've noticed, games where our defense gets off the field on third downs, we typically have won those. And whenever we allow NFL record setting amounts of third downs to be converted, league worst third downs to be converted by our defense, we lose games. So that's a clear correlation between winning and losing, stopping the opposing team on third downs. And originally, we were like 5 of 7 on third downs at one point. Then we just didn't convert the last 6 on offense, so we ended up being 5 of 13. But again, I mean, we were planning to go for it on fourth down, so we didn't even try to get those first downs. Remember, Joey Sly got hurt, and we were trying to avoid kicking a PAT or a field goal at all costs, so we were literally playing for fourth downs. We weren't even trying to necessarily convert those third downs at all costs, so I'm not going to take off too many points from just the offense overall for us going 5 of 13, because that box score doesn't tell the whole story. But that 4 of 12 that our defense allowed definitely does tell the whole story. Our defense balled out for the majority of this game. We allowed a huge play in the beginning, they ended up scoring off of it. Bobby McCain, bad play after that. He got everything together, and the only other big play we really gave up was the Shaza Everett looking lost on that last touchdown where they looked like they may end up coming back and winning the game. But other than that, man, the defense held it down on third down. Shouts out to Jack DeRio. We'll get to him at the end of the defense. But the defensive line stepped up huge. No Montez Sweat, no Chase Young, no problem. Shaka Tony, Casey Tuhill, and James Smith Williams did exactly what they needed to do, playing assignment football, only doing what their responsibility asks them to do, being very disciplined, not being selfish, not trying too hard to play hero ball and get a sack. They did exactly what they needed to do, set the edge, and sacks came to them. Shaka Tony had two big plays. He chased down Russell Wilson for an almost sack. It ended up being like 3 yards. Then he got a sack later on in the game. Huge, man. I'm so excited about Shaka Tony. I still think that if we could somehow develop him into a Sam linebacker, I think that's his highest ceiling. But he is a great edge rusher, man. I'm really excited about him. He hasn't even necessarily shown off his elite bend that he had coming out of Penn State, and he's still balling, setting the edge in the run support, man. It's just crazy, bro. For him to be undersized and setting the edge the way he is, this is exactly why me and so many other people have been so excited to see him play, because he has a lot of talent. He's one of those guys that's super determined, and you saw it on the field today. So again, we would love to have Chase Young and Montez Sweat. We're going to probably get Montez Sweat back maybe by the first Cowboys game. But, like, they're holding it down. And the guys up the middle, Jonathan Allen was getting double-teamed and still eating. He didn't get a sack, but, again, he was getting double-teamed, and he got plenty of pressures. He was on Russell Wilson all night. Plenty of knocks to the ground, all kinds of stuff. Deron Payne had a pretty good game. But Jonathan Allen is that guy on the defense. He's still our best defensive player. Him and Kendall Fuller are our best defensive players, period. But shout-outs, again, to all of the defensive line, because they stepped up. Even Matt Ioannidis made a couple of plays in the run game today. I haven't heard his name in weeks. I mean, it almost seems like he's not playing, but today he stepped up big time a couple of plays. And then moving to the linebackers, I mean, we're still not using Jamin Davis like he's a first round pick. He's not in the game that often, at least that I noticed, but he made a couple of plays. One open field tackle he made when the Seahawks were trying to tie up the score when they were down 17-9. Of course, they were gonna have to try to go for a two-point conversion, but he made a great open field tackle, and I believe we ended up forcing them to go three and out soon after that play. So man, Jamin Davis made some plays. He doesn't look like a first rounder yet, but he's learning. There's definitely some progress there. Cole Holcomb looked pretty good from the most parts that I noticed him. I have to go back and watch film on him and Jamin Davis, because I didn't really notice them much, but I guess that's a good thing, because as long as they're not getting beat in coverage, we're pretty straight. Cole Holcomb has some really good coverage on one catch that the Seahawks completed, but I mean, it was just a really good throw from Russell Wilson, probably his best throw of the day. Good coverage by Cole Holcomb, but just a better throw. He had his hand right there, and then there was somebody covering the guy. I believe it was like Bobby McCain that was actually covering the receiver, but Cole Holcomb was in front, and the ball went like right here. And Jamin Davis almost, you know, he almost got up there and got the pass that Kendall Fuller picked off, that two-point conversion that pretty much won us the game. Now, moving to the secondary, again, Kam Curl, it's between him and Jonathan Allen, who are our best defenders on the entire team. Kam Curl, to me, is second, but that's not a bad thing. I mean, he's out here balling. The open field tackles, the coverage, we really appreciate him. I mean, I don't understand how he made it to the seventh round. We all slept on him coming out of the draft. Well, everybody but like a select few people, but I'm not one of them, man. I didn't know he was going to be this good. Now, in training camp, his rookie season, Ron Rivera kept talking about him, just kept talking about how he doesn't make the same mistake twice. He's going to be a really good player. And that's when I was like, all right, Kam Curl might be something. Even before his first regular season game, I was like, okay, Ron Rivera's talking about this guy, so that must mean something. And Ron Rivera was definitely ahead of his time, because Kam Curl is out here balling, man. He's definitely, Logan Thomas in his press conference said that he's a top five safety in the NFL, and it's hard to disagree, because again, like I've been talking about in several videos, like I talked about in my most recent video, I believe it was, or maybe the video before that, Kam Curl's impact doesn't show up in the box score, because you have some guys that have 10 tackles a game, but none of their tackles have as much of an impact on his very few tackles that he may have. But usually he's like somewhere top five on our team in tackles, but even when he only has like four tackles, usually his four tackles are huge tackles, like open field tackles, game saving tackles, like that one he had against Christian McCaffrey in the open field. I mean, you could probably count on two hands who can tackle Christian McCaffrey in the open field, and Kam Curl is one of them. And then he's good in coverage as well, man. I'm so happy that Landon Collins has moved to linebacker, and we just let Kam Curl completely dominate the strong safety position, because he's balling. And speaking of Landon Collins, him moving to linebacker has been huge. This was one of his best games, low-key, man. He was out there making so many plays. I love that blitz that Kam Curl and Landon Collins had on Russell Wilson. They both got there about the same time. Kam Curl had a further distance to run, but Landon Collins had to go through a running back. I mean, he pretty much had the running back with one arm and Russell Wilson with the other. Man, they're both balling out, bro. Landon Collins and Kam Curl, man. Moving Landon Collins to linebacker is one of the best decisions Jack DeRio's ever made in his career. Us as fans have said that he been needed to do that. It took him forever, but I'm glad he finally did it. And then Kendall Fuller, man, this was his best game of this season, at least. I mean, he was out there making play after play after play. And that two-point conversion interception where he just went and took it, like, that was the exclamation point on it. That this is his best game in the season, easily. William Jackson III, Didn't really hear his name today, and for a corner, that's a great thing. Didn't necessarily make plays, also just didn't get thrown towards much because I'm assuming he had great coverage, but again, that's just something else I'm about to go watch on film and see why he wasn't getting thrown towards. Was it good coverage, or was it just Russell Wilson not seeing receivers? But overall, if you don't hear a corner's name, that's a good thing. I mean, DK Metcalf only had one catch. It was on that final drive. It was like for like 15 yards or something. Again, Tyler Lockett's deep bomb was on Bobby McCain. So Cameron Curl, it seems like Benjamin St. Juice didn't even play today. But again, if you don't hear a corner's name, that's a good thing. That means they're not getting picked apart. We still got to do a better job of catching interceptions when they come to us, even including Cameron Curl. But overall, the secondary was great today, man. I really appreciate them. And Bobby McCain, I mean, outside of that touchdown drive in the beginning of the game where they just threw that deep bomb against him, he had a pretty solid game. After that, he corrected his mistakes. And again, the secondary lockdown overall, great communication. We're not just having a whole bunch of deep balls thrown on us because of a lack of communication. One was Bobby McCain not in the right place early in the game in the first quarter. He corrected that for the rest of the game. And the other one was DeShaza Everett, who came in for a very rare snap, and he was just completely lost. Other than that, secondary held it down. And then before we move on to special teams, Jack DeRio, man, you're finally coaching. These past few weeks, you're finally coaching. I don't know why it took for Chase Young and Montez Sweat to be out for you to finally start throwing blitzes at quarterbacks, but ever since you've been blitzing with the safeties, with the linebackers, it's been working, and we've been getting a lot more pressure, especially how random it is. Sometimes we only throw four, and Jonathan Allen will just get there on his own. Sometimes you throw seven at the quarterback, and we get there immediately. We need those. We've been asking for that all season. I'm glad you're finally doing it. Jack DeRio has this defense playing well and playing pass. I mean, they're out there like putting their lives on the line. Some of these open field tackles, some of these diving plays for interceptions. I mean, I just really appreciate the way the defense is playing. We got to give Jack DeRio his credit for how good they look, especially with how angry we were with him in the beginning of the season. We have to be equally as happy with them these last few games now that our defense is starting to ball out and look elite. Because remember, I keep saying this, last year, even though our defense put up elite numbers, it was like against who? What quarterbacks? Now, they dominated Tom Brady. Cam Newton had an overall good game against us, but they made stops when they needed to, and now they just shut down Russell Wilson. Now, granted, Russell Wilson doesn't look like his usual self ever since he came back from that finger injury, but they still shut him down. And then special teams, I mean, Joey Slye getting hurt, that sucked. I mean, I really hope he's healthy enough to come back. I mean, just imagine that. Think about like that from Ron Rivera's point of view. You now don't have a real field goal kicker. You're on the 30-yard line. You have to go for it on fourth down. When we get a touchdown, we went for two instead of just kicking an extra point. Like, that completely changes everything, and the Seahawks knew it. The Seahawks knew that we were pretty much going to be going for it on fourth down because we didn't have a good field goal kicker after Joey Slye hurt his hamstring. And we still made do. So shouts out to Ron Rivera for that, and the special teams coordinator, Nate Kaxer, all of that, man. Hey, we made do what we had. Get well soon, Joey Slye, because we need you. Because up until that block kick, he had never missed a kick or a PAT since we've signed him. He's been balling out, been perfect. Then that block kick, and then he didn't even hurt himself like on the block specifically. He hurt himself trying to chase the defensive lineman down like nobody touching him. So that was just a pointless injury. But hey, man, it happens sometime. Get well soon, because again, we need you. Tress Way was out there kicking his life away. He made some great punts today, flipping field positioning and all of that. We really needed that. And DeAndre Carter overall was good. It looked like he almost broke one off at one point. And then he also looked nervous sometimes, like he muffed one punt. Sometime before that, it looked like he almost was about to muff one. So once he calmed his nerves, he got back right. I still definitely think him and Tress Way are Pro Bowlers this year. But yeah, man, overall, great win. Again, I think one of my biggest factors is getting off the field on third downs for our defense. I think that's easily top five reasons why we won this game. There's a lot of reasons, but that's definitely one of them that a lot of people may not notice or think about. And man, shouts out to everybody stepping up for all of the injuries that we have. I mean, we are injury ridden, and we're still out here winning games against fairly quality teams. I mean, the Seahawks are 3-8 now, and it looks like they're trash, but they're really not that bad. We just made them look bad by being more physical, running the ball, and playing better defense. And I'm excited about this Raiders game, because I think we can honestly go out there and win that. They're in shambles. They beat the Cowboys, and a lot of people are going to be like, okay, they're not that bad of a team because they beat the Cowboys. But they were doing so many things to try to sell that game. The Cowboys just did a better job of selling back. Raiders and Cowboys just going back and forth like, here, no, you win. No, you win. I'm good. No, you win. So I'm not afraid of the Raiders. I think we can honestly beat them by double-digit points, honestly. So I'm excited about that game. But, man, thank y'all for the support, man. Shouts out to everybody that pulled up to the stream and donated, man. It's my birthday, so I got to wake up early soon. So I'm going to go ahead and edit this video and get it out. But, man, that's a great win. We beat Russell Wilson on his birthday yesterday, and then it's my birthday the following day. So I'm happy they got me a win for my birthday. Shouts out to the Burgundy and Gold, because that doesn't happen often. And again, shouts out to everybody that supports the stream. Shouts out to everybody that called into the post game live stream. A lot of great points. Again, shouts out to everybody that donated to the live stream, especially to my birthday specifically. I really appreciate y'all. And of course, man, shouts out to all of my sponsors, especially my Pro Bowl sponsors, whose names you see scrolling on the screen right now. And I really appreciate y'all. I'll catch y'all later. I'm out.